Yeah, yes.
Money may be going through things, but I just wanna say, the other day when we had that earthquake, and I was in the room, I was getting dressed, and I didn't know what was going on, and my girlfriend called, she said, "Arlene, did you feel that?" And I said, "Yes." I said, "What was that?" She said, "That was an earthquake." Mm-hmm. Well, God has been dealing with me ever since.
Amen.
I don't know what's going on or why it's going on. Or,
amen.
You know how God deals with you in different things, and God is really pricking my heart in different things. I'm just asking everyone who knows the word of prayer to keep me in prayer.
Amen.
We are living in the last days.
All right.
Yes. And God is soon to come. So just keep me in your prayers.
All right. Thank you.
So informative and so worthwhile. Going to ask you also, as we close here, to keep the world foremost and to keep Israel, the Gaza Strip, and those people basically who are not taking part in this. It's in the military, and I don't want to even describe war. I don't want to try to describe war. May God bless those people.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Doing your prayers.
Amen.
Maybe you can
Amen.
Say a word or two for them and say a word that we can become more of a loving nation. I just don't know why. It is so very difficult for us to get along.
Oh, yeah.
May God continue to bless all of you and bless this country.
Not my mother, not my father, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my mother, not my father, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's for Brother Warwick. He loved that song. I'm surprised he didn't sing it for us this morning. He's supposed to sing that song, and then I know it's you. Go ahead.
Thank you so much.
Standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me. It's, point to yourself. Standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me. It's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. Not my sister, not my brother, but it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. Oh, not my sister, not my brother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. I'm a little out of order because that's not the song, the hymn that was saying. When the Spirit hits you, you just go ahead on and do it sometime. But I like to acknowledge that I'm a little out of order according to what was planned. God bless.
Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen again.
Amen.
How about one more time for the Holy Ghost?
Amen.
Amen. The Lord is so good. Amen. He woke us up this morning, and he started us on our way. I don't know about how you feel, but I feel like praising the Lord. Am I right?
All right.
Come on, somebody. Amen.
I wish you, Pastor.
Let's give God some praise in here today. Amen. God has been so good to all of us. Am I right about it? And we just want to acknowledge that the Lord is in his holy temple. And let us reverence him on this day. Psalmist said, I was glad when somebody said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. And so we're going to have an opening congregational hymn.
Page 411.
Selection number 411. Selection number 411.
lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me.
See, trust him.
Trust him, and do not trust a word that is.
I'll draw all men unto me.
Lift him up, lift him up, till he speak from eternity. Let the world in you the Savior see. Then men will gladly follow him who once taught, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, lift him up, lift him up, till he speak from eternity. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, lift him up, till he speak from eternity. Lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me.
God bless you and heaven smile upon you. Amen. You may be seated. This time we're going to have the reading of our announcements. Following that, we're going to ask Reverend Bell to give us a scripture. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I just have a few announcements to make. St. John's Baptist Church Scholarship Committee is asking those who can to make a donation to continue our support for our high school students and our graduates for this year, headed to college in the fall. We have Simone Johnson, who's graduating this year from high school, and Jalen Greer. And we also have a Siani Bagwell, who's graduating from college. So we want to, you know, give something like we usually do. You have the yellow envelopes in your packet. If you don't have them, just, you know, bring what you can and support. They're asking for support for students. Also, tomorrow, advisory council meeting / business meeting will be held at 6 p.m. Okay, at 6 p.m. tomorrow. Ask everyone who can to attend. And just a reminder, I'm not sure, but the Motown tribute show, is that sold out? Okay, that's what I thought. Sold out, that's a good thing. And just to announce Mother's Day tea, Saturday, May 4th, 1 p.m. to 3:30 p.m., right here at the church. Please wear your favorite hat. Food, fun, games, and prizes. Donation is $15. This is sponsored by our nurses department. Okay, and that's it, I think. And we do have, still have the little pamphlet we did last week for some of the yearly events. So just focus on that. And if you have any questions or want to add something, just let me know. Call the office. Thank you so much. God bless.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
Pastor. I'm reading for you here this morning, Acts, the Gospel of Acts, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Now Peter and John went up together in the temple at the night hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which was called Beautiful, and asked alms of them that entered into the temple. Who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked alms. And Peter, facing his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, exceeding to receive every something for them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Amen.
Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. We want to ask that we would be prayerful for our following named individual sick and shut-in. Sister Pansy Cummings, prayer for the Perry family. Amen. Deacon Clifton Jones, Charlie Thompson, Sister Isetta Kimbrough, Michelle Myers, Sister Gracie Montgomery, Sister Margie Miller, Trustee Rosie, and Jermaine Jackson, Brother Rufus Muzon, who was here on last week, and Sister Krista Jackson, Sister Lily, and Ducky Avery, and Stephanie, her daughter, settles. Prayer for my family, Lisa Richardson, Douglas Moreland, Betty Cardena, the Groom's twins, Leola and Inez, Richie and Mark Morrison, Deacon Sam Hood, Pastor Anthony Bell, Reverend Bell's brother, Sister Genevieve Mapp, the mother of Sister Roxanne Mapp Bacar. And we also want to announce we received notification just earlier today. Sister Katie Harvin called and let us know that her son, you know, Siobhan, Brother Siobhan Harvin, he's in Robert Wood Johnson Hospital in New Brunswick, and he's getting a new kidney this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yeah. I visited him a few times, and he had a lengthy stay in Helene Ford a few months back, and it all had to do with that kidney. And you know, my sister had a kidney transplant, I guess 5 or 6 years ago. She go everywhere. Amen.
Amen.
Her and her husband just got back from, I don't know, somewhere. I think Detroit this time. They all were they getting ready to go to Africa in a few months. Amen. Amen. So she got that new heart, you know? I mean, not the new heart, new kidney. So they're able to do some fabulous things now, and thank God for that. Amen? Because it gives these individuals a new lease, basically a new lease on life. Amen? And my sister was so fortunate. Tell you how good God is. She said, "Oh, I don't want no kidney transplant. I done lived a good life." So her husband said, "Well, no. So let's just put you on the list anyway." Jefferson Hospital in Philadelphia. So he worried her. So she went on and put her on the list. And you know, sometimes you can stay on that list for years, you know? And she had the kind of blood type that shot her to the top of the list. She was only on the list about 4 or 5 weeks. And they called her and said, "We got a new kidney for you." But 4 or 5 weeks, you know? And she went in, and that was for 5 or 6 years ago. She said, "I'm glad he talked me into getting put on that list." Amen. Because she just said, "Ah, that's all. I done lived a good life." So It's just amazing what God can do. Amen?
Amen.
Now, and we thank God for that. We're going to ask that Deacon Randy Morrison would come and lead us to the throne of grace. And let us be prayerful for Sister Grace Montgomery.
Yeah.
You know, I know she was supposed to have been released. If anybody heard anything, let us know.
I talked to her yesterday, and she's supposed to be coming home sometime this month.
This month?
Yes.
All right. Is she still in England?
She's in London, yes.
Lord, have mercy. Yeah. I tell you, boy. Well, thank God. God is over there, too. Amen?
Yeah.
So we're going to keep her in prayer, and we're going to ask that Deacon Morrison would come and lead us to the throne of grace. Oh, and we also want to announce, you know, what used to be, because we got a new system, we didn't know the pandemic was coming, but thank God the unit, the women got together and got with the men and the Unity Day race. This was just before the pandemic. We had no idea that the pandemic was coming. And that September before the, no, November before the pandemic was to hit, 2 or 3 months later, the women got together and raised $40,000+ and they put a brand new sound system in, amen? Everything's computerized in the back. You used to see Lisa sitting up front and she could operate it right from the cell phone right up front, or they could do it in the back. And now we got everything with it. Now, it was a very expensive system. I think it cost like around $33,000-$34,000. But now we got live streaming. Don't even need the cell phone up here. Now they got live stream. Everything's being done from the back. Am I right about it? So technology is taking over. And just think about God's timing. Had we not had a few months before put in that system with the technology that would enable us to do live streaming, when everybody flipped over, to being online, we wouldn't have been able to do that. So you can't beat God's timing. Am I right about it? We had no idea the pandemic was coming, but God knew. And thank God for the women. Amen. The women got together and raised that money. Am I right about it? Come on, somebody. God is good. You look downstairs, and we thank God the women got together. I hate to keep saying the women. The men too. But when you're talking about money, the women raised the money. The men just go along to make it look good. Am I right about it? Come on, somebody. Yeah, we all know that. Am I right about it? But we got a new hardwood floor downstairs. You ought to look at it, and it looks good down there. So we thank God for the hardwood floor, too. Am I right about it? Come on. God can give you a hardwood floor. Help me somebody.
Good morning, church. Let's go to the throne of grace. Gracious Father, again, we come to say thank you. We thank you, Lord, you woke up this morning and you started us on our way, Heavenly Father. And you guided us all through last week, Lord, through your resurrection Sunday, Heavenly Father, the most powerful Sunday in the year. It's a Sunday, it's our Christianity Sunday, it defines our Christianity in you, Heavenly Father. And we say thank you, Heavenly Father.
Right.
As we come this first Sunday, Heavenly Father, we ask you, we want to partake in a communion, Lord. We ask you first, you forgive us for our sins, Lord. Bless us in a mighty way, Lord. Thank you for what you've done for us, Heavenly Father. Continue to live in us as we walk in you, Lord. Bless us, Lord. Heavenly Father, we have mercy on us this day, Lord. Then, Heavenly Father, we heard some good things that you've done for us through our congregation. We ask you, we just say thank you, Lord, for what that was done, Heavenly Father. Thank you what you've done for this institution, for this church, Heavenly Father. Thank you what you've done for us, Heavenly Father. Thank you for our women. Thank you for our men. Thank you for our pastors. Thank you for each and every auxiliary here at St. John's Baptist Church, Lord, and for all the churches, Lord, as we are here to worship, honor, and glorify your name, Lord. Understand, this life of living is all about you and none about us, Heavenly Father. We just want to praise, honor, and glorify you, Lord, because we know through you all things are possible, Lord. Right. Heavenly Father, we ask you to put your hand on the sick list, Heavenly Father, as it grows from week to week, Lord. We ask you to bless each and every one, Heavenly Father. Yeah. Thank you for what we heard from about Brother Siobhan Harvin, Lord. We ask you to continue to bless his family, Heavenly Father. Bless his, touch his body, Heavenly Father. We want to see him back here serving you, Lord. Then we ask you, Heavenly Father, to bless Sister Gracie Montgomery, Lord. She might be a long ways away, but you're there also, Lord. So we ask you to touch her body, give her healing power, Lord. Continue to stay with us, stand by us, Lord. Bless each and every one of our congregants who come out this day, Lord, for whatever reason, but we just say, praise you, Lord. Bless them all. Each one of us has issues, Lord, but we know you are the great survivor. You are the great creator of everything, Lord. So every situation, nothing is too big for you because you're a big God. And we praise and honor you, Lord. We glorify you, Lord. We know, Heavenly Father, you are a way maker. So whatever way that we need to go, we ask that you make it, Heavenly Father. We all have situations in our lives, Heavenly Father. You know what they are, but we know you will make a way for them, Lord. Bless us and keep us, Lord. Keep us going strong for you. Keep us coming to you regularly, Lord. And as we leave here, Heavenly Father, let us not forget you, because this is a 24 walk in you, Lord. As we walk in you, glorify you, magnify you, because you lead the way, Lord, and we follow. We ask you to continue to remain in this as we remain in you. We give our lives to you, Heavenly Father. We say in this world there's going to be trouble, but you told us to be of good cheer because you have overcome the world. Heavenly Father, we love you. We glorify you. We bless your name. And we say thank you for everything, Heavenly Father. We can't thank you enough. We had 10,000 tongues. We can't thank you enough. Heavenly Father, continue to stay with us. Stand by us. Bless our families. Bless our world, Lord. We heard, bless Israel, Heavenly Father, Hamas, Lord, you know the world, Heavenly Father. This is all, you know what that's about, Heavenly Father. We ask you also put your hands on Haiti right now, Lord. Put your hands on Africa, Heavenly Father. They all need you because we know you're not just here, you're everywhere, Heavenly Father. So we ask that you continue to be with us, stand by us, bless those countries, bless us as a person. Let us continue to grow so we can magnify and glorify your name and bring others to you as you would want us to do. Heavenly Father, we ask all these blessings in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Down by the riverside. Down by the riverside.
Down by the riverside? Okay.
Many times we didn't have a voice during the daytime or to get together as a people to say that we want to hold a meeting for certain things, and we had to give it out in signals and signs and in songs so that others would not know what we were planning, and someone would start a song to say, gonna lay down my burdens down,
down,
oh, down.
Down by the
riverside. Gonna lay down my burden down,
down by the riverside.
To study war, no, I ain't gonna study war, no, I ain't gonna study war, I ain't gonna study war. Down when I get down, I'm gonna put on my long white robe down to study. I ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study. my golden shoes down. When I get down, what down? I'm gonna tie up my golden shoes down to study war no. Gonna meet my loving Savior down. Sometimes we think about when we're having difficulties in life and like nobody seems to care, but always remember that someone cares for you.
All right.
Someone is praying for you. And most of all, remember Christ died for you. Amen. That's most important. The song is one is heaven. Heaven is looking down on me when I'm lonely and confused. I know the Lord will see me through. When my friends do me wrong, think about it, I just shake it off and go on.
All right.
When I lay awake and can't sleep, just in your mind, think about there's an angel sitting at your feet.
Well.
Then you just rest on in Jesus, right? Always remember, I'm awake, I can't sleep. But you know why I can't sleep? There's an angel sitting at my feet. Why can't I sleep? Heaven is looking down on me.
God for our male chorus. Amen.
Amen.
They're doing a magnificent job, and they didn't just get that way. They've been doing that for a long time. Am I right about it?
Amen.
We thank God also for our men's fellowship, who Amen. Have led us in our devotion on this day. Amen. Thank Amen. God for men who are on the battlefield for our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Today is our communion Sunday, as of course every first Sunday is. And, you know, we want to say to you, those in radio land who are listening to us, you may get your communion elements together at the end of the service. Now, before we leave out of here, we're going to commune together. Am I right about it? And so that's where our preaching this morning will come from, the book of 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, verses 24-26. 1 Corinthians 11, 24-26. This is what it says. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." And after the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." Amen?
Amen.
For a few moments today, we want to talk about table talk. Am I right about it? Pray with me, if you will. My Father and my God, we ask thy blessings now upon the word that shall be preached. Lord, we ask that thou would move and have thine own way. Prepare the hearts, the minds, and the spirit of these thy children to receive thy word. Hide me now behind the shadow of the cross, so that no one will see me, but rather Christ within me. Then, Lord, we ask that thou would save somebody's soul, cleanse them this day, and make them whole. In the name and through the precious blood of Jesus the Christ, we do pray. Pardon me. And all of God's people did say, amen. What do you talk about when you gather about the dinner table? The family dinner now is becoming an endangered entity in America. We find that today only a few families actually observe a daily family meal in which all the members of the family are together for at least one meal of the day. When I was a kid and I was growing up, we all sat down and we ate together. Amen. And nobody ate until Dad got there. Am I right about it?
Yes.
Come on, somebody. Right. Sometime I was hungry, I'd say, "Hurry up, Dad. Come on." You know. You know, while most families strive to achieve this goal, it seems like with the schedules now of the modern family, it's harder to be able to do that today. And at the table, we used to find, we talk about wholesome and positive things. The family would talk about its hopes, would talk about its dreams. And at the table there was fellowship. At the table there was much interaction from the youngest up to the elderly. Am I right about it? The meal is the reason we gathered, but the most lasting impact was the interaction between family members. Much was to be learned around the family table. Amen. Amen. Sometimes table talk can be revealing. You'll recall the story of little Eddie when he told his family about his day at school at the family dinner. We'll find that little Eddie went on talking, and he talked a little too much, and it revealed a whole lot about him. Little Eddie said, "Miss Jones said she was going to pick one person to sit on the front seat and be the class leader. And she said that me and Johnny were her final two choices." The family listened as little Eddie was talking. They were passing all the food around the table. And he said she decided to give us a test in order to decide which one he or I was going to be noteworthy of getting the getting the star. Am I right about it? And Eddie said, because she said we were about the same in everything. And so Eddie revealed that when the test ended, Miss Jones picked Johnny to be the leader of the class. He was going to get the gold star, even though both of them missed one question. It was number 10, a question on the test that enabled her to give it to the other one and not to little Eddie. So little Eddie, after class was over, he went and asked her, "Hey, the teacher, why did you pick Johnny over me? We both missed the same question. We both missed question number 10. Why did you pick him over me?" And so the father said, "Well, little Eddie, what did Johnny have as number 10 as his answer?" Eddie said, "Well, he wrote, 'I don't know.' And I wrote, 'Neither do I.'" Am I right about it? And so we find that sometimes table talk can be revealing. When you'll recall another story, a few church women were sitting around the table and they were talking one day. The subject turned to their husbands. One lady said, "Well, my husband just won't go to church with me. Since that joker won't go to church, I think he's going to go to hell." And this led to talk around the table about all the different women's talking about their husbands. One complained, she said, "Well, I got a husband, and he won't go to Bible study." And another complained, she said, "Well, I got a husband, and he won't participate with any of the other church men." Another said her husband never participated in family prayer or devotions. And it was generally agreed that with one reason or another, all the husbands were going to end up in hell. And so the church women started speculating about themselves. One woman said, "Well, you know, I try to be good. I'm sure I'm going to make it to heaven." And each began to talk about the reason why they were good wives and were all going to go to heaven. They noticed that one of the ladies wasn't saying nothing. Come on, somebody. They looked at her and said, "Well, you're quiet. You're such a nice lady. Surely you're going to join us and go to heaven." She said, "No. The first thing in the morning, I'm going to buy myself a ticket straight to hell." And they were shocked. They would buy a ticket straight to hell. Well, she said, "Well, if what you say, ladies, is right, then only women are going to be the ones in heaven. And if I'm going to get my ticket right now, I'll be the only woman in hell. And that'll be heaven for me. Am I right about it? You know, when we gather at the Lord's table, what ought to be on the mind? What ought to be on our minds of every believer? We ought to concern ourselves with positive and wholesome thoughts. Am I right about it? But what ought to be them thoughts? Well, at the Lord's table, we focus. We ought to be. We, the main reason we come to the communion table is to remember. Am I right about it?
Right.
And so if that's right, then we ought to think about his death. Am I right about it?
Right.
And we ought to think about the fact that he promised in his word that one day he was going to return. And it brings us hope. It brings us renewal. Am I right about it? It didn't bother me a whole lot. It did at first when I thought about the fact that my brother passed, my father passed, and the next year my brother passed, and then some years after that my mother passed. And the reason it didn't bother me a whole lot is because when I thought about it, I knew that I was going to see him again one day. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
Because Jesus said in my father's house, many mansions, he said, if it were not so, I would have told you, but this is the part I like. He said, but I go.
Right.
To prepare a place for you. And
yeah,
he
right.
said, if I go to prepare that place for you, I'm going to come again one day to receive you unto myself.
Right.
And then here it is right here. That where I am, there ye may be also.
Right.
Well, Reverend, how you know they're going to be there when you get there? Because you remember when Jesus was hanging on the cross, and there was a thief on one side, and the thief said to him, Lord, take me with you when you enter into your kingdom. And so there, if you want to know how quick you can get to the kingdom, Jesus said, okay, I forgive you. And so this day shalt thou be with me in paradise. Come on, somebody. So if Jesus gonna take a old no good thief that ain't did nothing but kill and rain and mob and raid people all his life, if he'll take him to heaven right away, then you know that our loved ones are waiting for us when we get there. Am I right about it? And so I like that. Am I right about it? And so as Christians, we grow stronger when we fellowship together at the table of our Lord. It renews our hope in faith that one day our Savior is going to return, but not only that, we're going to have a reward. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
Our text focuses in on Paul as he gives instructions to the Christians at Corinth about the proper observance of the Lord's Supper. And in his passage, Paul gives the Corinthians a good talk about the table of the Lord's Supper and exactly what it means to you and to me. And it began by explaining what the Lord's Supper was not. Yeah, he noted that it was not for a feast, for eating, and that wasn't the primary reason that we come together, because the Corinthians had expanded the Lord's Supper to a point that observances had become nothing but giant feasts and potluck dinners. Am I right about it? Those who came, Brother Deacons, bought baskets of food, and they stuffed themselves, am I right about it, so they could hardly get up from their tables. And those who were fortunate had plenty of food. Those who were not watched as the others gormandized themselves, and they actually stuffed themselves. They drank so much wine till they became drunk. Am I right about it? Come on, somebody. And Paul noted that an observance in which eating food and getting drunk, if that's the primary reason, he said, that's not why we are to come to the Lord's Supper. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
And so he wrote in 1 Corinthians 11:20-21, he said, when you come together, therefore, in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. That's not the only reason that you come, for in eating everybody taketh before the other his own supper, and one is hungry, another is drunk. Am I right about it? You don't come here to eat and get drunk. Am I right about it? He said, that's not what the Lord's Supper is all about. So in verse 22, he said, those who want to eat four meals, go home and eat. Am I right? Come on, talk to me, somebody. He said, go home and eat. But the Lord's Supper is a symbolic reminder rather than a feast. Am I right about it? And so he went on to say that the purpose of the Lord's Supper is to recall the sacrifice that the Lord made for you and me, for the remission of our sin. He said the bread gonna represent his body, and the wine gonna represent his blood. And he said, taken together, they gonna remind believers of his life and substance, both of which were given for what? For the remission of our sin. So Paul noted that the Lord's Supper is a time not only of reflection, but it's a time for us to engage in spiritual reflection. Am I right about it? Self-examination, Reverend Bell. But also, I heard Sister Arlene doing it this morning, Thanksgiving. Am I right about it? Spiritual reflection, verse 26 notes, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death. Come on, somebody, until they come. So the elements of the Lord's Supper are to prompt every believer to remember that salvation is only conditioned on a sacrifice given by Jesus himself. Am I right about it? They remind you and I that the sacrifice made required real blood. Am I right about it? And the loss of real life. Am I right about it? And so in making the sacrifice for you and I, Calvary, Jesus paid for our sins. Am I right about it? The Lord's Supper causes you and I to reflect on that sacrifice. So that's what spiritual reflection says. Well, Reverend, what about self-examination? Well, go to verse 27 and 29. It'll remind every believer of his personal covenant and promise to God. Am I right about it? Right. Each believer, that's you and that's me, and that's anybody else who would come to the Lord's table, ought to come with an attitude of seriousness. Am I right about it? But also of self-judgment. Am I right about it? Paul said no believer ought to participate in the supper of our Lord unworthily. Well, Reverend, what does unworthy mean? Well, it means in this context irreverence. It refers to a person who participates in the observance and takes it lightly. In other words, you're just doing it as a ritual necessity, but you're not really discerning the Lord's body. Am I right about it? Which means you forget or ignore the fact that the observance is extremely sacred because it represents the body of our Lord. Am I right about it? The self-examination is one of motives and intentions. It's personal, it is private. But Thanksgiving, verse 24, shows what the Lord himself did at the Lord's Supper. What did he do, Reverend? Well, number one, he gave thanks. Come on, somebody. He gave thanks for Calvary, Reverend Bell. He gave thanks for the difficulties that lie ahead. He gave thanks for the troubles that were yet to come. He even gave thanks for his death. Am I right about it? Showing gratitude is expected from every believer. Give thanks to God for everything. Give God thanks for the good. Give God thanks for the bad. Am I right? Give God thanks for the sunshine. Give God thanks for the rain. Give him thanks for the warmth and give him thanks for the cold. Because you'll remember Romans 8 says all things. Come on, somebody. Whether you like it, whether you want it or not, all things work together for the good. Am I right? Come on, somebody. And as believers, what do we talk about, Reverend? When we assemble at the Lord's table, do we talk about current events? Do we talk about other people? Come on, somebody. Did we talk about the latest fashion? You know, you can't be a good Black Baptist if you don't talk about each other sometime. Talk to me, somebody. Come on, somebody. Yeah, yeah, if you ain't never been talked about, join the church. Am I right about it? Come on, help me, somebody. Yeah, yeah, it's some a bit hard. Well, we won't hurt you. In the end, we'll come and put our arms around you. Am I right about it? Some a bit hungry. Do you wish for a larger portion? Or some a bit thirsty? And do you want a larger wine glass? Table talk to a large descent, extent to send on the setting. Am I right about it? Luke 14:124 gives an instance in which Jesus himself talked a whole lot at the table. Am I right about it? And as Jesus dined with his friends, he talked about being sensitive to the needs of others. In other words, Jesus talked about helping somebody else. Am I right about it? He talked about being humble. Am I right about it? But he talked about sharing with others and taking advantage of opportunities. Am I right about it? Jesus talked a lot at the table, and his conversation was interesting. It was informative, but it was also upbeat and very positive. But however, when Jesus approached the Last Supper, his conversation began to shorten somewhat. When he talked about giving thanks to God, and then he talked about Calvary. And this from Jesus, we get two subjects to talk about at the Lord's Supper: thanks for Calvary and Calvary itself. Am I right about it? And from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, we get the third self-examination. Am I right about it? Let's look at each one of them. Let's give thanks. Am I right about it? When Jesus talked at his Last Supper, he gave thanks, and yet the thanks he offered was not for anything he had received in the past, but he offered thanks as he looked forward to the crucifixion and death that was coming on the next day. Am I right about it? And as he took the bread, Reverend Bell, and then he broke it, he realized that just as that bread was being broken, that so too would his body be broken. Am I right about it? And so he gave thanks for the bread and thanks for the sacrifice. And at the Lord's table, you and I, you ought to give thanks for everything, huh? We ought to thank God for protecting us from dangers, huh? But we ought to give him thanks for the difficulties that lie ahead. I heard 1 Thessalonians 5:18 say, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus, concerning you. In every situation, give God thanks. Not only do we thank him for the new job, but thank him when you get fired. Come on, somebody. When saints get together at the Lord's Supper, there's plenty to thank you, the Lord about. There's plenty to testify the Lord about. There's plenty to praise the Lord about for his goodness and mercy. Am I right about it? Also, we got to look at self-examination. The Lord's Supper is a serene time when we hear not the voices of others, but when we hear our own inner voice give to us what I call self-talk. It's the time when we examine ourselves and when we talk to ourselves about the life we live and the life we want to live for the Lord. Self-talk comes in our quiet moments when we've removed all other considerations. Self-talk looks deep and asks questions. And some of the questions that we ought to ask, am I involved? Come on, somebody, in serving the Lord. And if not, I ought to be about my Father's business. Am I doing my best to be a true child of God? is my lifestyle. It odds what the Lord wants it to be. And so Paul said, after self-examination, you ought to not partake in the Lord's Supper if your own self-examination shows you that you're unworthy. Instead of blessing normally derived from participation, Paul said, the unworthy participation will bring damnation upon his own soul. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, come on somebody, eateth and drinketh, damnation unto himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. When the saints gather for the Lord's Supper, there ought to be a time when we examine ourselves. But finally, my brothers and my sisters, when we get together for the Lord's Supper, not only should there be a whole lot of talk around the table about the goodness of the Lord, but we ought to talk about what the Lord has done. We ought to talk about what he's doing right now. And we ought to talk about what we know he's going to do. We got to talk about Calvary. You see, Calvary, is the essence of the Lord's Supper. What happened there is the reason for our salvation. Because there, out on Calvary, Jesus became sin, dying in our stead, so that we might have a right to the tree of life. When we gather together, like we're going to do right now, at the Lord's Supper, there ought to be a whole lot of table talk. In the secular world, there are a whole lot of rules that govern what you ought to talk about at the table. But we find that it's hard for us to follow those rules when we get around the table of the Lord. Come on, somebody. The world tells us not to talk about your problems. Don't talk about your troubles at the table because that'll stop your food from going down properly. But you and I, children of the heavenly King, when we got a problem with that rule, because any time we're in the presence of the Lord, we can talk to him about all our problems. And he'll hear our cry. Come on, somebody. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden. He said, and I will give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and I'm lonely in heart. And in me, come on somebody, you're going to find rest for your weary soul. He said, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's why the songwriter said, let's have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles. Come on, just a little talk with Jesus. It'll make everything all right. You see, the world says that when we come to the table, you ought not whisper to the person next to us and point because it's not good manners. But when we come in the presence of the Lord, we have to keep breaking that rule because everything about us point to the goodness of the Lord. if we talk about our family, that points to the goodness of the Lord. If we talk about our job, that points to the goodness of the Lord. If we talk about our health and strength, that'll point us to the goodness of the Lord. Come on, somebody. We got to talk about him. Because can't nobody do us like Jesus. We got to talk about him. Because can't nobody do us like the Lord. We got to talk about him. Because he's a heart fixer and a mind regulator. We got to talk about him. Because he's been good. Ain't he been good? We got to talk about the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley and the bright and morning star. Come on, somebody. There's a story about an old lady who was destitute and starving as she prayed to God for help. One day the king saw her lowly condition and decided to help her as an example of his benevolence and goodwill. Later, she got an invitation, that old lady did, to a banquet where she was gonna sit at the king's table as one of his guests. And so in preparation, a matron warned the old lady. She said, when you get to the king's table, come on, it's considered an insult. Yeah, to refer to the king or any of his good works at the king's table. If he called upon to speak, you ought to be cordial. But while you're being cordial, if asked to call upon to speak, never refer to the king. Well, sure enough, the old lady was called upon. There she was, surrounded by nobles. There she was, surrounded by lords. And the old lady, she tried to hold it together. But the more she tried to hold it together, something inside of her, she wouldn't let her hold it. She said, I want you to know there is a man at the table. And he has turned my whole life around. She said he had put clothes on my back. She said he put shoes on my feet. She said he brought me out of darkness to where I can be in the marvelous light. As she sat down, Reverend Bell, the matron frowned and said, didn't I tell you? Not to talk at the king's table. You're going to lose everything you have because you weren't supposed to talk about the king. The old lady said, well, wait a minute. When I said there was a man at the table, I wasn't talking about that king, but I was talking about the King of Kings. Come on, somebody. She said, and I don't think he's mine. If I tell the world that he'll make a way for you. Today, my brothers and my sisters, there's a man at the table, and I'm here to tell you, Reverend Bell, it's all right to talk about him. It's all right to tell the world how he picked you up and turned you around. It's all right to tell the world how he planted your feet on solid ground. The world might say it's not polite to talk with your mouth full, but that's the best time to tell the world about the goodness of the Lord. Tell them that he's anointed your head with oil. Tell them that your cup runneth over. Tell the world about a man named Jesus. Tell the world that he died one day on a Friday called Good. Tell the world that he slept on Friday and Saturday and most of the night Saturday night. But tell the world that he was buried. Come on, somebody. But on the third day, tell somebody, after he slept on Friday, tell somebody, after he slept on Saturday, tell somebody, after he slept most of the night, Sunday, Saturday night, tell somebody, that bright and early, Sunday morning, tell somebody, as the sun began, to mount its fiery chariot, tell somebody, before the owls hooted, tell somebody, before the rooster crowed, tell somebody, before the birds made their way in the blue ether, tell somebody, before the Lord began to let the fish swim in the sea, tell somebody, that early, early, tell somebody that bright and early Sunday morning he got up from the grave. And when he got up, he said, I got all power, both of heaven and earth in the palm of his hands. We're coming to the table of the Lord. But when you get there, it's all right to praise the Lord. When you get there, tell him about a wonderful Savior. Tell him he's a rose of Sharon. Tell him he's a rock in a weary land. Tell him he's a bridge over your troubled waters. Tell him he's a shelter in your time of storm. Let him know if you're down, he can pick you up. Let him know, can nobody do you like Jesus? I'm going to talk at the table. But what am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about the goodness of the Lord. I'm going to talk about how he saved my soul, how he cleansed and made me whole, how he picked me up and turned me around. Hey, it's all right to talk about the Lord. If he's ever done anything for you, you ought to praise the Lord. If he's ever picked you up, praise the Lord. If he's ever healed your body, praise the Lord. If he ever put running in your feet, clapping in your hands, joy bells in your soul, praise the Lord, give him praise, give him glory, yeah, he's all right, I said he's all right, go and praise the Lord, give him praise, give him glory, he's all right, I said he's all right, yeah. Praise the Lord. Table talk. I'm going to talk at the table. But I'm going to talk about the goodness of the Lord. Because he's been good to me. Am I right about him? The door of the church is open. All you got to do is confess your sin. Believe that Jesus Christ lived. Believe that he died. Believe that he rose again. Whoever you are, wherever you are, just as you are. And if you won't come now, see me before you leave service today. Am I right about it? And we will bring you in that way. A whole lot of folk are comfortable with coming when a whole lot of eyes on them. Am I right about it? But you come to the Lord any way you can, in any way that's good for you. But the important thing is that you do come. and you make your calling and election sure. Whoever you are, wherever you are, just as you are. Let's bow our heads in a moment of prayer. Lord, we ask that you would speak to the hearts, you would speak to the minds, you would speak to the very spirit of these your children, because we all need a closer walk with you, but we all need to come to you. We need to confess our sins. We need to have a belief in the fact that you lived, died, and rose again. And then, Lord, we need to accept you into our hearts through that faith, that belief, that affirmation. We need to know that we're saved, Lord, saved from the uttermost. Amen. To be with you in eternity. Please, Lord, we ask that you would touch the lives and touch the spirit of some man, some woman, some boy, or some girl, that they might realize their need for you, and they might have strength, that you would strengthen their ankle bones, their knee bones, that they might walk for you to acknowledge you as their Lord and risen Savior. Bless them and bless us all. And we're going to prepare now, Lord, to come around the communion table. And as we do, Lord, help us to remember. But we want to talk, though. We want to talk after we take a self-examination. We want to talk about the goodness of the Lord. We want to talk about all the wonderful things you've done for us. I heard Sister Arlene testifying just this morning about how the Lord had strengthened her and brought her from her fears to her cheers in the Lord. Am I right about it? And how can nobody do her like Jesus? That's basically what she was saying. And that's what we all saying, Lord. But we love you, and can't nobody do us like you can. So as we come to the table today, let us remember your sacrifice and what you've done for us. We're going to have table talk, but we're going to talk about the goodness of the Lord. Bless us all. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. God bless you. We want to ask that each individual who has their red hymnal, we're going to ask, there are two ordinances that we recognize in the Baptist Church. We commune to show that we are soldiers in the army of the Lord, but we baptize so that we show that we are new creatures in Christ, that old things have passed away, and behold, all things have come new. Today, out of the two ordinances that we recognize, we want to recognize the sacred and holy ordinance of communion. Amen. We're going to ask that those who are able to stand comfortably to do so. If not, you may remain seated. Amen. I know some folk have issues with and they can't stand. They can't stand long. And everybody, it's right in the front pages of your red hymn book. And I'm going to ask that we read together. Having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, we do now in the presence of God, angels in this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. We engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, walk together in Christian love, strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines, to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations. We also engage to maintain family and secret devotions, to religiously educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from the sale and use of intoxicating drink as a beverage, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy and feeling and courtesy in speech, to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure it without delay. We moreover engage that when we remove from this place, we will as soon as possible unite with some other church. We can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. Now in him who brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, be power and glory forever. Let the church say amen. Amen. God bless you. Now, there are two ordinances, and we're recognizing we're about to enter into the sacred ordinance of communion. Amen. And we'll recall that Jesus the Christ had gathered in an upper room. And while he was in that upper room, it was then and it was there, he began to tell them of the things which of necessity must befall the Son of Man. We're told that it was then, we're told that it was also there, that he took the cup and he took the bread. He broke the bread and he looked at the cup and he blessed them. And he said, this is my body, which is shed for you. Amen. This do in remembrance of me. And so we know that we're unworthy to enter into any covenant with the Lord, but Jesus' blood makes us worthy. Am I right about it? We're nothing but sinners saved by grace, but because of the blood of Jesus. Am I right about it? When Jesus looks down and he sees you and me, he sees us, through his shed blood. Am I right about it? And that makes us worthy. Am I right about it? Well, we got a brother who is worthy, and he's willing and is able. He sits at the right hand of the Father. While we may not be worthy, he's worthy, and his name is Jesus. His job is to sit at the right hand of the Father and make intercession for you and for me. We're going to ask that Reverend Bell would come and pray that God would change these emblems from that of a common to a spiritual use. Let everyone pray with him and for him as he shall come.
Father God, it's in the name of Jesus that we come this morning. The sacrifice that you laid down for us, your body is to be broken for us, your wine to be to the blood of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, that you would bless this table. Bless those that take this sacrifice this morning. Let it be more spiritual than carnal. And Father God, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Bell.
Thank you, sir.
Now, let us think about our Lord. Let us think about how he was battered. He was beaten. He was bruised for our sins. He was beaten for our iniquities. Scripture said the chastisement of our peace was upon him, but it also goes on to say, by his stripes we are healed. Amen? Let's eat of his body. Thank you, Lord. Let us think of your awesome sacrifice for us. Let us remember. also then, and it was also there that he took the cup. For we know the scripture said, without shedding of blood, and this cup represented his blood in the New Testament. Scripture said, without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission for sin. So in other words, if Jesus hadn't died, if he hadn't been willing to shed his blood for you and I, we would have no home in heaven. We would have no right to look forward to being with the Lord when we leave here. We would still be stumbling around in our sins. But because of what he did on Calvary, because of the shedding of that blood, because he paid the price. Somebody said he paid it all to him we owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but hallelujah, he washed it white as snow. Songwriter said, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me then whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let us drink of his blood. Amen. Scripture said that after they had done that, they were all together on one accord. Then they sung a hymn, and they went out into the Mount of Olives. Well, we don't have any Mount of Olives, but thank God to, because of people that work on beautification of our church outside, we can go out of these doors and where it looks almost like a natural bouquet out there at this time of the year. We can rejoice in the Spirit of God who has blessed us and made a way once again. Pray for one another. Pray for our nation. Pray for our world. Pray for our sick. Pray for our shut-in. Pray for our bereaved. And pray for one another, because we all stand in the need of prayer. Somebody say, not my mother, not my father, not my sister, nor is it my brother. But it's me, O Lord. I'm the one. I'm standing in the need of prayer. Amen. May God bless you and heaven smile upon you. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us continue in it. And let us rejoice and be glad in it all the way. May God bless you and heaven smile upon you. Amen. Let's look to the Lord. Merciful Father, we ask your blessings now upon these your children. We ask you to lead them, guide them wherever they go. And bless them, Lord, because life gets hard sometimes. Sometimes the load gets heavy, but we know you're a burden bearer, and we ask you to bless us and to lighten that load for us. Let us know that you are there for us every step of the way. So we thank you for being with us on Table Talk, Lord, today. We felt your spirit. We felt your presence. Never dismiss us. In the name of Jesus, bless us now as we leave this place. And keep us safe until we come back together again. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. And all God's people say, amen. But do I see the Lord? No, Sister Joyce Baker. I want to see you. Come up front a minute. I want to holler at you for you. Amen. God bless you. And I'm up here up front.